at the bar swivel like pooches to a snatch. But too bad, fellas. It's just the beleaguering vapors of Andy's early start, punching in a few feet ahead of him, eager to take liberties with the imagination and stay a while. Officious sunlight pinch hits for Cleeks, and Andy takes the revenant showman's cue, slipping the gap sideways on his heels, toothless, grinabeen, arms outspread, his vibrissa geared on a sucker's best wishes. By the half, he's greased a covey of hard-ons, gussied up in their niner livery, chumps, one and all, lifting a slurry of shots and praise and grief until the final score comes down and Andy's quarry grows decidedly tight. The saloon emotes under another sweat and something about a woman returning again and again to the lonely field of the dome lights when the car Sunday, Andy steeps himself in his hands, drooping against any number of troubled domestic cereals, licking his chops, always munching gums, his mood votive in autumn's slipping rays. When the beloved ladies pass, he remains as if in prayer, oblivious to the innocent few who dawdle over him, then politely fade to the back room, where the faintly prevalent pool balls soon have Andy dozing. Tendered by Lutz.
Thank you. the sky can't penetrate, or pivot around in like a sky should. It sows among a child's cryptic secrets, chiding vector and field as it breaches, tapers downward, cobra-like, in its first offering at form. I remember how memory will serve it, like guilt or loss or shame, will frequent the scenes of their arrival, taking care to instill their burden of proof, leaving nothing but words resting across time. Try to explain something eventual. We were given birds and gave in turn bomber planes. More vertigo. And the measure he conjures further and further upward, backflips, and stares back at him. The blueprints of several ideas ache beating his signature. Among the studied spin of street corners. This he takes away for himself once he stifles our breath, stringing out the number to a point of threat or starvation. But he's just dancing, and vaguely sad too. Because his song must turn and run arcing into another season. Suddenly. Bite into and drink the water he's freed from ringing trees. He sees the anonymous drunk man staggering across slat-lit streets. His steps like a desultory tickling of keys. An agenda is back in tune. Work in the morning, and of course, the blues. Sunday's early morning skies, royal partly to biz. The clouds seized at mid-swoon. Indications stall, and being so motionless, work through their every element, every possible design. Not storming, and not storming again. So that dawn becomes a moment in time much larger and less enforced, abandoning all skies to a sudden fiction. Far below, the shore tugs at the sightline, and the sightline in turn answers with a mute roar. Until the moving and pulling of so many delicate influences evolves upward, allowing a bandwidth, a live wire. And finally, the sun's jagged minarets to quietly persist against a dying swath of white caps. Peripheral shapes return to boats, and the simple heave of logic brings him back from his late night, diminishing all former threats. The silence fades, and a once monitoring sea and sky step away from the car with them, in portraiture, in compliment, but no less willing to destroy them.
Thank you.
Dazzling Nova under shut eyes. So maybe it is you're turning 40, Jack. That ramshackle Coolsville floating across your scowl as the sign in this bar blinks a demanding red sin. All the boys and girls are diamonds at the rounds of their tables, mewling under the jazzscape like intellectual pedants at some Parisian feed circa the lost generation. But we both know the risk factor in here is lacking brass. The foreheads or tails, man, Kitty, and just too smooth for a surrealist trapped here in a Mission Night's grab ass alone. A veritable Cupid's last rites when you, Jack, are thinking, how her hair fucks when she walks. The curls buoyed on each elaborate placement of the is she Jean Tierney and Laura? Or is she just another wank coming to a slow boil on the can's back burner? I can only wonder what that offshoot glance entails. A handsome, though churlish grin becomes a tintype of poise and intimacy. Your lone countenance thrust out from the pleasing lacquer of dim sconces. Nah, wait a minute. Check that. Not thrust out, but blazing through this flesh bath like a fucking lodestar. Your near avuncular status pitying this middle-class assembly of shoegazers and morose fraud. Jones and long before they ever took the so-called pipe of the quarter century mark. You suffered through long and dreary New Hampshire winters. Hopped up on cocktails that would have a pharmacy scratch in his head and shit. Even you didn't know after a spell. But that was the whole damn point. Departure. Sealed. A fuck off. Cobrio. You suffered further still through staid New England airs. The cabinet maker's son caught fire. The guy who fled Central Casting and landed in Clorox headquarters. Dried out 15 years, but still awash. Still awash in the proverbial fists of your own mania. But these bush leaguers aren't concerned. It's fickle pussy they're after. Who can blame you? Your own new curiosity agrees with the Catholic schoolgirl, Jack. Though your eyes and innards speak elsewhere. In fractured spells of looms and darts, stitching the crooked, wrinkled sheets, as the breathing coalesces with the scent of rat air. That cigarette of yours mistakenly takes on a curious charm. Its taste subsumed and full. And it ain't after meal one either, boy. Because when the pecking order is morphed from the assorted lips of old girlfriends' faces to that dead air beside you, there are no longer any Valentinos, sir. Thank you. high fogs have since moved in and brought stillness. Nobody's out. The contemplative life has locked the cupboards on the world out here, drawing out our capable solitudes, mine walking, yours what or wherever. It could very well be a far later hour, if not for the waxwork of a rain's after night, and the train that's just pulled in at the base of the hill. Puddles render the sky perfectly. Depleting their surfaces just deep enough to allow for a depth and a clarity this passing Narcissus borrows on the slab. Watching myself in the overhead drifts. One in particular, it can almost be heard at lurk speed. Through the reflection as if somehow giving a taste of the afterlife. All that fairy tale drollery just might be true. That the dead are clouds now and comprise the fogs that pass in the eyes of occasional parking lot puddles. Contained but living before the real time resumes and they move out into the rest of our lives, continued on, waiting out our senses to hatch something more than a name. Announce their brawn at the windows. And somewhere at the far end of the abandoned villa, a door slams shut. Tensed, they listen to the echo. Suffering the imminent conjunction of boot falls and vehement command. Until the echo melts away. Its impact, once stark, then tapering, and gone. A hung note collapsing comfortably at their side. They lie back again. At sea, she says, offering words. The feather drops from nowhere, or from somewhere they no longer care to see, demanding of its dipped like spinnaker a languid free fall against release and eventual disappearance. They'd swear it was chuckling, but sighting it gives it weight, watching it as is a symbol, or a soul, or time, drifting down into the hue of the canvas, where she reaches for it. No, he says, pulling her gently back. Let it, he says, meaning the memory. Plazas guarded, its nights under blackouts and curfews, and by their definition, a gangly tableau of knocking knees and elbows falling drunkenly, though far more serious than that in the streets. She turns on the radio. Two quick forms, she removes his hand from her arm, saying low, I promise, low. From a lilting consolation by turns droopy and descendant doped. She hums flatly to the melody, dreaming into it as he turns to her side of the bed. Emptying darkness like a morning sun that tracks a snake.